higher. Hi.
Hi, morning everyone. So sorry for the delay. So today, as I know, it's the last day of summer school. So I'm going to show you just like some one of the hottest topics in the machine learning field, deep learning. So before we start, I want to know, so how many of you just like already work on the deep learning stuff or already have some actual work on deep learning? So maybe hands up. So cool. Yeah, very many people love. Many of you just like in the computer vision, come from the computer vision community. Well, oh, okay. Yeah, okay. Cool. So if for some of you they don't know, so just like today, I'm going to check. Yeah, just like I'm going to start with some just like motivations to know just like why is just like deep learning is just like make people just like so excited, and it's just like why industry just like spend a lot of money or just like also time on this. And then we, because deep learning can be also say that so sometimes it's reviving the neural network, which is just like 20 or 30 years old technique. So I'm going to show you some basics, and followed by some just like popular deep learning models. And later I'll show you some just like practical, just some practical tricks of how to just like to train the deep learning models. And if I have more time, I'm going to show you more application, especially in the deep learning processing. Cool. And yeah, the name deep learning really sounds fancy. Just like, in fact, so it's just a specific form of representation learning. And especially it's focused on just learning deep representation of data. So in the past, no matter what kind of field you worked in the past, so mostly just like people use lots of just like handcraft features and just like write some program just as they extract the feature by themselves, for example, for this cat or this dog, and try to identify if it's just like the specific just like categories of the image, or if the natural language processing, so mostly people just like get a bag of words from the text and try to just like maybe sometimes come up with some syntactic features. Yeah, if you're just like being in the Mark Johnson's lecture, so you probably know a lot of different kind of way to represent the text with the syntactic features, and even the semantic ones, then put them into some just like classifier. In the NLP communities, many times, so just sometimes some kind of glorified linear classifier. So what's the problem there? So people found that, so now because it's a big data era, and the data is big, and actually just like real data is complex. So in many cases, it's totally impossible just like describe the data with purely just like linear classifier. That means that you just simply, you cannot simply just draw a line to just like between just two completely different just like sets of data points, right? And so this phenomenon is somehow called just like the underfitting. So that's why just sometimes people just like come up with the idea of representation learning. And yeah, probably just like if you work in the deep learning before, probably haven't also noticed just like the news from New York Times with just like how many computers just like Google used in order to just like identify cats, right? So at the beginning from the headline, so it sounds like a little bit strange, just like why Google spent so big amount of time and also money, just like just try to identify some cats from just like some from frames from YouTube. What they actually do, just like what's actually big hit for the people, actually just like they try to learn feature detectors from a large amount of unlabeled data. So before the machinery just learn data, so they have no idea just like certain amount of data is somehow actually about the cat or about the face. So they develop a technique basically is called just like it's a variant of autoencoder, and which I'll cover later in the lecture, maybe just like the next half of it. And to when they just like train the autoencoder, spot autoencoder on just like frame from millions of YouTube videos, they kindly found out just like certain neurons. So because autoencoder kind of kindly also can regard it as just a kind of neural network. So certain neurons, they really specialize for certain kind of objects. For example, some of just like can detect face especially well. So and some neurons can fire some pulse. If we see some cats or dogs. So, and people have also used some techniques to visualize a little bit. So later, that's why so there's some just like interesting picture from the this article to show just like some blurred cat. So actually before deep learning, so people already have also just like planned a different way to try to do some representation learning. But the thing that don't do quite deep. So for example, so the for computer vision, my familiar with like pipelines, there's like people start with just like extract some shift feature from the images and apply some k-means and later just like try to extract some feature for the clusters of from these clusters. Then later on do some pooling operations and before fit them fit feature into the cloud file. And if you're from the natural computational linguistic communities, so there's also some structures that you start with just tracking backward features. You might just like for certain tasks, for example, passive speech tagging or name identity recognition, so you can try to learn the Brown cluster from backward words, and especially for the bigrams, and in order to just like get some just like word clusters. Later, you can fit them just like into the class file. And the same idea also applies for the audio processing. Yeah, maybe just a differently, just a mostly the mixture of Gaussian is more popular than them just like hard clustering from which were popular in the other communities. So, the thing 2006. Why people just like begin just like excited about deep learning? Because since then, people found out a way to learn really just like deep architectures. That means that in the past, people can most learn just like two or three just like layered just a neural network. Now people found out that it can sometimes for some application it can come up just like 30 or even more layers. And why do we just need some kind of so many layers? So, mostly, they are more expressive than the shallow architectures. And we'll talk to this a little bit here. Here, I just want to give some intuition. For example, so probably if you work on this stuff, so the images on left column, so already seen several times, so people kind of expect it just like deep learning architect, start with some just the pixels of the images and try to identify different just like mini shape. Maybe there's some part could form some circles, some could form some triangles later. And we learn a higher level representation, which can just like could be a composition of just like low level shapes, maybe form some just like ears or eyes. Later, just like when we people can apply more just a higher level, just like representation learning technique to get higher level representation in order to just like get the physics. And for languages, so and different syntactic trees of sentences, for example, already suggest some just composition of patterns, especially just like non-phrase consists generally just like of just like maybe just of nouns and or maybe some just modifier, for example, adjectives and or prepositions. And in this sentence, and I got it from just like sentiment tree bank. So later you'll see also just like a live demo. And in this sentence, so the two found ugly meanings, the beautiful things are corrupt without being charming. So if we want to just like correctly identify the meaning, for example, find ugly meanings, so this can be further decomposed into just like ugly meaning. So it's better to just like start with identifying some low-level ones, so for example, ugly meaning, so it's like ugly modified meaning, so later, and both of them are taken as argument of the verb of fine. So yeah, it's somehow the natural way just like people just like of learning. So for example, just like people just like start with some simple concepts and later just like build more, learn more complex the concept based on this just like primitive concept. Yeah. So some people are crazy about deep learning because that's just like deep learning already become just like already have applied to many different areas and get the best results in many applications. So here's an example from just like Pascal and video object class challenge. So this kind of challenge is started just like have some annual evaluation just every year since 2008 or just even earlier. So, and recently, just like the group from the Oxford, just like visual geometry group, so they have just like run some extensive evaluations of the number of just like different representation techniques in the past. For example, so and see their performance here. So on the challenges, so. Around 2008, so the most popular technique is the bag of facial words. Simply based on the meaning, so from the meaning, from the name of the representation, we figured out that so they totally ignored some orders there, just like try to read some visual words from the images, and it's quite the whole architecture quite shallow because it's just like no. Multiple levels, simply one level of representation, and the performance actually just got 54 for the best system in that year. So, and later, people found out that improved feature vectors can perform better, and they commonly integrate also then sometimes Gaussian mixture to identify some clusters. And later, in the recent years, so the most popular technique and the most strong technique is the convolution, different variations, the convolutional neural network. And that's why so the three systems, so on the left column, so and it would be just like cheap every year, just like get the performance even better, just like from the 68 of feature back and improve further to just like 77, even just recently gets 82. So from last year. And so, however, this image data set contains just roughly just 20 different kinds of classes. And there's one just like more challenging task is called the ImageNet challenge. So for people not familiar with the computer vision. And it contains roughly just like, in this challenge, it contains roughly just 1,000 just like object classes. And in several images, it contains even more than one object. And it seems that from the Pascal challenge, mostly people try to only to identify some coarse-grained ones, such as the birds and the dogs, cats. Here, really just like further down to very fine-grained categories, such like quail and partridge, and also other different kind of cats. They sometimes also come up with just like even some more abstract categories. And here is just like some of the most recent results. I've got just like even one of them, just like the paper, even just like the PRE rectilinear nets. Actually, that one's still in the archive, so far as I know, so they are not formally published yet. So the most exciting result here now is that so the second column would be just like the human performance, because they asked some just like human annotators try to also just like label the images based on their just annotation guidelines. They found out that their system even just like slightly better than the human, because their system got just like 4.84, and the human is 5.1 just error rate. So somehow they in their paper they claim that so their team can somehow work better than humans than for the just like recognition task. And the top five error just means that they pick up just like make five predictions, that top five predictions. If one of them is correct, then you've got the score. So, and previously, the best performance system, even just like in the ImageNet challenge just like 2014, would be the winner was just like Google Net. So you think that so it's only a short period, so people always make just significant improvement. And especially in the past 2 or 3 years, so every year the people just like double the accuracy of their recognition systems. So it's somehow amazing. Most important that for SOCAMM system, so all of them are based on, most of, since 2 or 3 years, most of them different variation of convolutional neural network. And this kind of technique, and do not require really just like manually hand design features. And for the natural language processing, so the work of Mikhailov, so they have also some interest funding. So since actually 2003, people realized just like sometimes we can use just like the neural network version of language models try to learn the word representations. So here's the visualization. Here's the visualization of the word representations. And recently people found out that people can even just make some just like simple metric operations in order to just like infer some meanings. For example, if we apply certain operations, Paris minus France and plus Italy, you'll get the word vector very close, most close to zero. And the same apply also to just like Android minus Google plus Microsoft will become the Windows. So it's some kind of interesting finding. So people will still now to try to figure out, actually just like try to get more deep understanding of this. But currently, so mostly based on the empirical observation. And the last year, so the people also make also large improvement for the in the machine translation by using also a variant of the neural language model. So they try to use the neural network to learn some kind of just like word representation and phrase representation from the parallel corpus, and they get just like 3% improvement over the best performed one in the open machine learning machine translation challenge. And this paper even got just like best paper award in the last year's ACL. And because just like compared to the computer vision community, so the computation linguistic community is somehow a little bit behind. But recently, because that in the past, maybe just like before last year, so they published just like a paper around 2 or 3 papers about this topic, about using deep learning. So just like roughly 2 or 3 papers per year. So later they just improved further to just like last year, really a lot of research work on this. In last year's ACR, they got just like 22 or 24 publications around by using just like different techniques applied to various kind of applications. Yeah, as I said, just like deep learning really about just like learning representation, learning features. So maybe you can just like start with some just like concrete example to get more feeling just like why such kind of learning of such kind of features would be useful there. So one example just like to classify some phrases and words in a sentence. To determine its opinion, polarity of opinions. For example, just like if it's positive or negative. And there are a couple of example sentences here, mostly just like start with different just like book names and combine them with different subjective expressions. And traditionally, people just like use just like bag of words to represent them. So here would be example just a unigram to represent different just like phrases and words. Mostly just like it's also called one hot representation. Basically just like you set the corresponding ID index of the word to 1 if it occurs in the text. Otherwise it stays 0. And currently just like from this representation, so one thing you can infer that, you just can know that. So maybe just like something similar between the not helpful and the not difficult, but they're not completely just like, they're not completely just like the different. And mostly exciting Greek words just see the sharing of words, but it doesn't tell just like, do they share the semantic or syntactic properties? And another representation, so would directly just like you use the whole just like n-gram as one unit and encode them as with the one hot representations, then probably you'll end up with very huge feature space, and they'll run into so-called cursed dimensionality, because so you cannot expect just like you can get enough just like label the training data to learn them properly. So if that kind of phrases does not occur in the just like training corpus, you cannot expect your model can make a right prediction in the test set if there's some unseen words. So another way to see just like why just like the n-gram one, so not that so interesting, because that when we visualize the positions, you'll see that. So if we still try to apply our classical just like logistic regression or some kind of linear SVM for this task, it's already just like not clear how to draw the line between them, basically decision boundary between them to make them linear separable. So that means that so for really just like complex tasks of natural language processing, so some of just like commonly used techniques actually didn't work well. So at this point, I want to say more about this, because mostly really a lot of, not about the linear classifier, a lot of different kind of machining technique can also be considered as just suffer from the similar problem. Because one of the reasons we use the machine learning techniques, so we want to get good generalization, right? So we want to assign correct label to some just unseen text, data points. So just like the green one here. But mostly we start with some just like red points here. So just like with what we call just like training data points. And most time, if we want to learn some just like learn some kind of function, we starting with just like interpolating them by using different kind of smoothing technique. We'll probably just use L1 or L2 regularizer. If you are familiar with some just like same-sequence learning technique, for example, just a label propagation, you end up also just like special kind of try to smooth your data in and projecting some low dimensional manifold. So more or less, they also apply some idea just like to try to smooth the function. So to make it easier to predict the data point, so unseen data points. So smoothing, another way to say smoothing, really just like assumption that so if two data points are close to each other, their label also just like they should be similar to each other. And mostly when you apply such techniques, it's also some just like it can apply some just like region, some neighborhood close to the training data points, so they cannot go too far away. Maybe just like in order to capture some shared properties. But however, so in the real life, so real data is more complex than this. So people just have some kind of belief that so many of data actually are generated from some just like highly curved manifold. So you can imagine just like some kind of just like curved surfaces, smooth surfaces, and maybe many cases they are just low dimensional. And but however, so there's lots of properties that should be shared around different regions of that kind of feature space. And when the dimension of the just like feature space comes into questions, sometimes we got into so-called cursed dimensionality problems. So especially when we use non-parametric methods, for example, just like a kernel density estimator. So here, just like the picture, just like to see clearly, just like maybe we'll start with just like some one-dimensional one, seeing that it cannot have too many just like variation of data points. So we go to the two dimensions. So you can really just like two-dimensional or the third dimension, we can just like simply just like the possible data points, possible input input configuration to grow exponentially. So people have also just like some theoretical results on this. For example, for the kernel density estimator or Gaussian, or the kernels with Gaussian kernels, or the kernel machines with just like Gaussian kernels, they found out that the mostly people can want to get some low expected error, right? So you want to have good machine and really want them to make as few errors as possible. And so people analyze that. In order to achieve the low error, so people need to get just like low bias and low variance. So the theoretical results suggest that. So if you just like simply increase the dimension of the filter space, you'll end up the complexity or grow just like exponentially. And so even if we don't consider the factor of dimensionality, so you might come back to the one-dimensional case, you'll see that the problem can be also just serious when your function have lot of variance, just like lot of up and down just here. So if you still just apply the second smoothing technique, and if your data point happened to be a little bit your training data point are not sufficient enough, you'll see that so you cannot get good prediction, for example, for the just like for the blue point over there, because it's not in the neighborhood of any of the training data points. So that's not saying that so the community that so not really earning about just like the curse of dimensionality. So what matters actually is just like the curse of just like variations, the number of variations. There are also just like some just like theorem for this. So mostly just like sometimes the people get some inspiration for the computational theory of circuit. And the people found out that the if you want to represent some just logic function with just like some logic functions, you really need some just exponentially many just like logic circuits and logic gates. And also the theorem here is about just like using just like Gaussian kernel machines. So suppose you want to just like learn some functions with which just like have just like lots of course up and down across the decision boundaries, which is the line here. And so it kind of expects just like kind of at least k examples in order to learn such kind of functions. Another example is think about that the function you try to learn the parity of your data points. Namely, you have only just like d bits, so from b1 to bd. So you want to see so if the number of bits is odd or even. And in this case, so if you still try to just like learn such a function with the Gaussian kernel machines, you really just have to put or just like a training data point at each up and down near the decision surface. So anyway, another way to think being just like really just like the required just like training example really grow just like at least linear to the just like the number of variations. And another category, just like many people use, is just like so-called semi-supervised learning. Especially among in this category, most popular one would be just like nowadays would be just like graph-based semi-supervised learning. For someone who knows such kind of technique, it's based on really just like strong smoothing assumption, just like this. So assume you have just like some just like labeled data point. The green and the red point over there, and you have lot of just unlabeled data around, so and the green one there. And what you want to do just like propagate the labels based on the labelhood. Just like so the point close to the labeled point should share the similar label. So you keep doing it further and get this. Finally everything's labeled. And compared to just like some hard clustering based methods, this one really can work just like some just like cluster with just like a curved shape, for example, the famous two moons problem. But however, so such kind of algorithm still can be considered as just kind of like a local classifier, because mostly they capture also just a local, just like property of the whole data. So the theorem suggests that after running just like a label propagation algorithm minimizing the training objective, the number of regions with constant labels that means that so each region will just like will have the same label, the support have the same label. It's less than and equal to the number of labeled examples. So from the figure below, so we can see that so different triangles correspond to different regions. So you can't expect just like the triangle with the same color would be indicated just like a region so with constant label. And you will see that in the last two, that if you don't have any labeled data, so probably just like all of them were labeled as green, no matter how strong the connection between them. So such kind of a local classifier, so the central idea really just like try to partition the whole feature space into different regions. And somehow each region somehow just like can take different, can have some shared property which leads to different just like labels. And so the RBF SVM and the nearest neighbors, k-means, a lot of current density estimates, a lot of such kind of models belong to that category. So as I said before, so the issue for this kind of way to represent the data is really the problem is that the number of the regions is linear in the number of parameters. Especially when we just like take a look at this formula here. So yeah, and this is somehow just like kernel machines, if you know in the previous lectures, just like they can all be write into this form. So the k would be the kernel just like function between the data point x and the point xj. So we'll compute the similarity between them. And the alpha j would just assign the importance to it. So for the linearity can be directly read from these functions in the way that the required just like example really just like if there are many different, if there are k different regions of just like such kind of k different regions with different labels, and really require just like such kind of k, at least k training examples, and the number of parameter grows linearly as well. So why don't we just borrow some just idea from the nature? So our brain doesn't work in that way. So our brain somehow just like use the so-called distributed representation. So actually it's a sparse distributed representation. So that's maybe our brain has a billion of neurons. So for the neurons, there will be any just small amounts of them will be active when we just see an apple or a cat or a dog. And there's also some redundancy there. And compared to previous representations, so the one significant thing about distributed representation is that so it's compact and just like the norm requires that so the features are mutually exclusive. So if the features are mutually exclusive, so that means that so in order to represent the difference just like kind of input configurations. And so we can use different subset of features to represent them. Not just like before, just use the ID of words, of ID of just like a group of words to indicate things. So we can use the combination of features to indicate just like properties. So the idea will also come to another concept suggested by Schopenhauer, just like so-called multi-clustering. So that means that a data point can belong to multiple clusters at the same time. So in order to indicate such kind of just like class membership, we can consider that so we have different just like hyperplanes which can separate just like the whole feature space into different partitions. And so we represent the data point by the way, so by just like in which region just like data point fall into. For example, in this case, if we have just one hyperplane, we can use one feature to indicate. So it belongs to the left side or the right side of the feature space. And if we just draw lines, we can represent more regions by growth any just like by using any one more features, right? So in this case, we can at least represent four regions. And following the same ideas, so we can just like keep going, just like, and can use just like limited number of just a few features to represent really exponentially many just like regions, right? So we want, that's the beauty of representation learning, so especially deep learning. So that means that we want a machinery that's with limited parameters, limited resource, and to represent exponentially many of input configurations. Yeah, that's somehow the important here. So by using this idea, so we can just like revise our previous representation of ideas. So we can just like also just like assume we have already just some clusters. For example, the one would be for that is the priority of the word would be just like positive or negative, or if the word with positive polarity is negated or not, that kind of features, and encode them as with different class membership. Here, we just assume for these phrases, also I just assume we apply some AND operations over there. And for example, by using some just like the neural network here, the neural network with one hidden layer, so it just have some encode code function. No, just like discrete, just like one layer neural network. So simply use the encode function to apply some AND operation, just like to encode the corresponding just like hidden representation. So in this way, so we just need just less parameters, less smaller size of feature space. So and in order to represent much more things, and the most importantly, just like we can use that kind of representation to capture a lot of unseen cases. So, yeah, we call our technique just like, because deep learning is not it called deep, mostly because it just like want to learn some deep architecture. Now we'll say just like why just like deep architectures makes sense for just like for representation learning. Yeah, the first, so our brain actually use deep architectures. Some for just like for some, when we see some images, so our brain might use up to just like 8 or 10 different just layers in order to recognize a corresponding shape or just even just more abstract object from the images. And another thing that, so also from the previous example, so just like we see the beauty of compositionality. That means that so we compose just like abstract, more higher level concept by just like composing the primitive concepts. So you know, composition also means nothing that so the reuse of the low level just representations. And before we just like started, just like just why it is so interesting. So the definition of depth we use here is just like maximum length of path from just like from the input to the output. For example, for previous the encode function for the sentiment problem, so that would be just like depth one. And we'll see that so a lot of just like machine learning models we use nowadays, so actually just like some shallow models, because that's locus regression, so it simply just maps input to some output. That's why it's depth one. And kernel machines are more complex, and because we can consider that the kernel function would be just like one kind of the input layer, and so to do some just like similarity between different data points, and later use a finer combination of a kernel function to get output. That's why it gets two layers. And boosting, because it's some kind of boosting and stacking belong to the category of just some kind of meta learner, just like in sampling methods, basically just wrap some just like another classifier, another learner inside. that means that so they simply add one extra layer on top of the embedded just like base learner. So sometimes so people might argue that so with Shaylo just like learners, we can really just like do a lot of things. So because that's so very just like famous, also just like also theorem about neural networks, that so neural network two layers can perceive any kind of functions. If we can really use two layers to perceive just like any kind of function, why do we bother to just use deep architectures? The problem is that so we, for certain kind of functions, we might end up with using exponentially many elements to represent them. That sounds not efficient, right? And for such kind of cases, people just like thinking about just like use, and if we use deeper architecture to do this, yeah, again, from the some inspiration or just like some from the logic circuit theory, so we may say that, so people say that so for certain kind of just like functions, we may just like use just a key layer to represent some just like to represent the, these kind of functions, which we may end up with using just a exponential number of computation elements with any just like two or k minus one layers. So another intuition from this, so we if we want to represent the polynomial here, so actually here's the network here is just like some products just like network. So the meta each layer to either do just like an AND operation or do the SUM operation. It's trivially. So we can use this directly to represent the polynomial, right? So, but use deep structure, we can reuse a lot of elementary elements, just like primitive elements there. And if we just like use low layers, probably we have to just like really just like multiply the whole multiplying out, we have may end up with use just like polynomial number of just like terms in order to represent the same polynomial. So another way of speaking, yes, so another evidence to show that deep architecture could be more expressive than the shallow architecture. And another idea so from deep learning is that people just like increase. So personally, I like it just like we want our just like machine learning models to somehow try to just like work similar to babies. And that means that so we expect that so we do not want the machine learning to use a lot of labeled data in order to just identify, for example, the difference between cats and dogs, right? So because the baby just learns the difference between the two just like animals, that's because do not need that the parent to tell the baby millions of times to say this dog, this cat. They just tell them just twice or third time, so really recognize just like the connection between the word and also the visual objects there. So the idea is that we really want to machine learning to do in a similar way. That so we give them just like a random sample for unlabeled data, maybe just download from the web or just for Google, maybe they use most of the data from the web to learn, to build up some model which can already identify the some just like structure of the data. So for example, just like this group of these circles, its shapes, maybe just like could form some cars, and other would be some, indicate some bicycles, right? And later, just what human needs to do is just like give some just labeled data to identify this region, automatic identity of region, should be labeled as cat. This region should be labeled as the human faces, and so on. This is really the idea of the self-taught learning. So people hope that so if we further improve such kind of technique, we can just like do not need to just like maybe 10,000 or 100,000 different kind of labeled data in order to train our model. That will be significant saving of the cost. And so the baby also suggests that what you want to do is really just like to to have some two-step things and start with unsupervised representation learning and use the supervised labeled data earnings to fine-tune our model rather than just like learn them from scratch. And from the mathematical point of view, so really want to the underlying assumption that so there are some just like shell structures among just like prior and just like also just like the conditional properties there. So if we shell some lot of explanatory just factors, which is planned just like the course, then we can end up using less just like labeled data. So one way is just like we just have just like the shelled statistical strength is from the unlabeled data, right? So another way is just like how about we learn multiple tasks together? For the natural language processing, we can end up just learning just like part of speech tagging, image recognition, semantic relabeling all together. Actually, this already people did done this just like in 2010 or earlier, and the Thena system and can train just like all these tasks all together with the neural network architectures. They found that so when they train all of them together and use the shelled intermediate representation and which built up from the worst representation, they can really just like make their system just like perform better than purely train them on each individual task. That means that there are really some things out there, so intermediate representation, which can be shelled across tasks. And so another thing that, so an idea would be just like to disentangle factor variation. So because usually people make just like manifold assumption about the data, so it can common assumption in many just like machine learning algorithm and models. So if the data are generated from the low dimensional manifold, we still want to project them back to capture really just like the in which direction the variance. For example, you have a robot, so in the real world, so perhaps it would have just like a different kind of movement. But however, to have just like a fixed number of degree of freedom. So if we can capture this, we can describe better the how different kind of movement of robot with that kind of with the degree of freedom, right? And so another thing really just like we want the machinery really to identify the explanatory factors inside the distribution, not just need to achieve some prediction task. If we can understand the explanatory factors inside the distribution, probably we can end up with just like doing better things. And the last trivial motivation would be that the most cases, if you just like apply just like handcraft features, we may just like can in many cases we cannot have just like cover any possible patterns. For example, for natural processing, if you want to do some application with multiple expressions, in many cases it's hard to enumerate all the possible combination words and your machinery without running into the curse of dimensionality problems. Of course, if we can learn the features automatically, right, so we don't need to spend more money on the engineers, so they can, so this is also the saving of the cost. So we've seen a lot of the deep learning, the basic idea of the motivation of deep learning. So deep learning can be considered as somehow another kind of neural network. For some of you may not familiar with this, so I'll cover some basics here. So neural network are really a traditional machine learning techniques. Actually, back into 1980s were quite popular. So it's one way of people just like to do some nonlinear classifications. So since the time of SVM, I mean just since 2000, and so people also get an idea to have some nonlinear kernels in order to achieve the nonlinear classification. But before that, mostly Pilgrim's idea is to just like to have some nonlinear activation function for the neural network. So it's called neural network because mostly people borrow the idea from the biological neurons. So the input wild would be some just like called the dendrites. So and so kind of neuron would just like connect to another maybe thousands of another neurons. So then it gets mostly it gets the input signals from the dendrites. And the cell will do something, and based on input, they decide to just like to activate and or send some pulse, and or just like the pulse will just like go further along the exosome to which will connect to the other neurons. And for the artificial neurons have also the similar idea. So you start with some input x, and its inputs are associated with different weight, so W1, W2, W3. And the sum of them, if the signal is strong enough, will just like send the neuron will be called activate and maybe trigger also some action of other neurons. But now, till now, here's just a linear, a finite combination of the input. So usually people just like write also in a matrix form, and you want the basic motivation, people writing in matrix form, one is for analysis, another just like, so when you implant just like neural networks, it's better to use some numeric libraries, which have a lot of very efficient implementations of just like matrix operations. And in order to get some linearity, one of the most popular functions people use is the so-called sigmoid function, which is the basic linear, which maps the input into just like into a probability region between 0 and 1. And we'll simply just like put the sigmoid function on the output of the linear combination and to get some just like output. So yeah, that means that the property about 0.5 in this case will consist that so it's just like the neuron is activated and file some pulse to the some output. And we have people have usually have other choice of nonlinear function. Another one commonly used one would be just a hyperbolic time function. So mostly the output space would be different, would be from the -1 and 1. And because in many cases people just really want to get some the negative output. Another one called linear rectifier, also commonly just like inspired by from the biological neurons. So if we, in most cases, it's just in the positive region, so it will be kept as a linear function, and in the negative one will be 0, which just like has the state of inactivate. And in this one, I just, sometimes people just usually people don't write the nonlinear function and the affine combination of input separately, most of them put together. So for today's talk, I just put two together with a doubled circle. That means that we apply nonlinear function on top of the affine combination of the input. So we can just use the artificial neuron to build our networks. Because really, as I said before, so really just like want to build up just like more expressive deep architectures. So for the neural network, the most common one is the so-called the feedforward neural network here. So we have some input layer, and so we'll build the hidden representation with in the hidden layers, and the output layer will just like maybe correspond to some classifier or just a regression, just like models. One thing you might notice that so if you apply, for example, just like sigmoid function as the nonlinear activation function, so we might end up with just like different interpretation of the same network. That means that so here we actually just have several logistic regression classifiers there in the hidden layer. So you might recall that I said before that so the beauty of distributed representation really just like try to represent the data by the membership of multiple clusters, right? So this classifier can be regarded as just like helper plane to divide input space in different regions. So it's really a direct representation of the direct indication of just like the distributed representation. And there are two common operations in such kind of feedforward neural network. One operation would be just like feedforward propagation. That means that we have the input, want to get the output. We start with just like first get the representation just in the hidden layer by compute the product between the input and also the parameters and apply the G is the activation function and to get the linear hidden representations. Then in the next propagation step, we'll just like propagate the all the information in the hidden layer to the output layer by applying just like the similar just like a finite combination of the input and apply the corresponding linear function. The linear activity function are not necessarily to be the same. They can also vary based on the applications. So if you write them in just like a matrix form, we'll just like end up with just like such kind of composite function. Yeah, so basically you just like some function will just like take the input of some another function as input, the output of another function as input. So another way of viewing just a neural network that really mathematically is just a composite function. Understanding the composite one would help us to understand how do we just like learn the parameters, namely the W there. So mostly we just come up just like some loss functions based on different needs of the applications. If the regression, probably we just have some squared loss. And if it's just like classification, maybe I'll have some coarse entropy and things like that. So mostly we just aim to minimize the loss function. And so one of the most popular algorithms we use just like can be belong to the variation of different of the stochastic gradient descent. So they have a very simple procedure. So it starts some random initialization of the parameters and update them and try to just like reduce the loss and until it converges. And mostly just like for neural network end up in some local minimum. And for the classification problem, so you may already seen this multiple times. So for the what given some labeled data, so X was the data point, Y was the corresponding labels, and we'll try to minimize the just like corresponding loss function mostly by minimizing the negative loss likelihood. And for binary classification, we might have just like the label encoded label to be either 0 and 1, and for multi-class classification, we still can use the one-hot representation to use the ID of the class to indicate the corresponding class membership. And here I just showed, for time reason, just showed just for the binary classification. So the loss function we have is so-called just like coarse entropy there, just like minus 1 log h s 1. So compared to the pure logistic regression, main difference that. So the logistic regression classifier at the top layer, output layer, will take just like the hidden representation as the input, rather than the pure just like the future vectors. This is the fundamental difference. Of course, later we can apply different kind of regularizer. For example, here is the example of L2 regularizer. So once we understand the loss function, just like most cases, just like the differentiable functions, we can compute the derivative, which just like here, which kind of just adds a search direction. Because we want to look for just like the good combination of parameters in the in the parameter space. So we need some directions. We also need some specific step size, which is alpha there. And so for how far we go. So for a one-dimensional case, really just like, and the derivative just takes the real, will be just over the tangent. the direction. So the alpha, which means that the safe side is just like how far we go. If we go just too far, maybe just like we're just like go to another, just like go over the local minimum, go to over the minimum, end up with less suboptimal solution. And too small will be just like move too slow. Mostly just like we have to adopt that, update the parameter multiple times to have certain paths from the starting point to the minimum. So now I just said just like the fundamental difference compared to just a logistic regression or just like linear classifier, really lies in just like the fact that we have the composite function. So here's an example, just like one example neural network in one-dimensional case. And the activation function would be just like symbolic function. So you see that in the forward propagation, we basically just like to take the input x and apply it into the composite function. And for the loss, we just like consider as a take a negative logarithm. And if we want to compute the derivative, we simply, with respect to different parameters, we take the training rules, and which actually is the product, or a product of different partial derivatives. And another thing, so we like to see that so for the first two partial elements, they are the same. And if the structure is more complex, we can't really just like think about, okay, we can, why not, we can use dynamic programming and to do the trick, to just like to save the some just the part derivative we already computed and reuse them later. And actually it's the, one of the basic motivation to have the so-called famous backpropagation. And talking about backpropagation, there's also some just like interesting story here that so actually it's a very old technique. And last year, I think Eugen Schimpop really just like tried to understand so who is actually a pioneer of the deep learning and who actually invented backpropagation. So he had run a complete study survey and sent just like email around so they think about to find out just like so collecting enough information to see who actually just invented backpropagation. But people found out that just even just 1980s. People have already some primitive form of backpropagation. But at that time, so it's not referred, it's not combined with neural network, just like use some train rules and dynamic programming to compute the derivatives. But so when we see today, it's already some kind of backpropagation. Just later in the 1980s, when people apply them to neural network, they become famous and taking the name backpropagation since then. So the beauty of just like of backpropagation really just like so when you just like compute loss in linear time, for example, so you can actually also compute the gradient also in the linear time because when you can reuse a lot of partial derivative by using just like dynamic programming. So when we look at the algorithm, so we can start with a simple just linear train backpropagation. And in this case, so x would be function input and z would be function output. So we'll see that so the little change of the input delta x will lead to just like the change, total change, multiplied by the just like partial derivative of dy dx will get just like delta y. And we'll get delta z, so in the similar fashion, that's the way we end up with just like the product of two partial derivatives. And if we have multiple paths, so we just need to sum them up of the derivative along each path. So by applying the train rules. So we can have also just like more complicated cases with more different kind of input variables. So really a matter of just like analytically, it's really a matter of just like applying the tree rules and so to compute just like the derivative along different paths. and try to reuse just like the ready computed one, and do not compute it over and over. So since the dynamic programming, so a nice thing that about aggregation that so you can design your neural network into just different modules. That means that so for each layer can be the cell for some modules, and it gets some just like it can get some input, and during propagation can get some errors from its parent nodes, right? So you can develop such kind of module without thinking so how it will be just like used later in different possible just neural networks, right? And for the software engineering, how to reuse some of the previous software modules, and quite convenient sometimes. As I said, so the backward propagation already a very old technique, and since 1995 was somehow since just like emergence of SVM, so people started using it because people found out that if we have just like really just a deep architecture, maybe with two or three hidden layers, and usually people end up with very poor results. And worse than the neural network with one layer, and easily outperformed by SVM, and which is shallow models. But 2006, Jeff Hinton just like published in this community kind of breaking work about how to learn, pre-train the networks in an unsupervised way, so-called just greedy layer-wise pre-training, so we'll see it later. And since introduction of this technique, so people can learn better just like neural network, and so that's why the reason that so people enjoying and using just like deep learning techniques. So in the past, why just like so simply using backpropagation is not that cannot achieve the good get a good models. So mostly because that so previously just like the neural network so start with some random initialization of parameters, and so basically it can land in after random initialization can all the weights maybe just stop somewhere randomly just in the whole weight space. If the weight space is very large, usually is that case. So you can get stuck in some just like sub-optima, local minimum, maybe in some poor local minimum. That's why the performance is kind of good. Because of the so Hessian gradient descent mostly can do just what it does, just like some local search along the direction guide suggested by the derivative, right? So they cannot think just like the don't have the knowledge of the global shape of the function. And backpropagation works especially worse for the recurrent neural networks. That means that neural networks, which for example, for time series or for signal processing, which have so very long layers, they find out that so the gradient and can either just like exploding or the vanishing exponentially proportional to the number of layers. So next, I think I just cover shortly about just like so some basic techniques of the deep learning models. So the one I said previously, just like proposed by Jeff Hinton, is the Rich Boltzmann machine, which is the fundamental just like building block of the deep learning technique, just like deep belief networks, which is the building block there. So Rich Boltzmann machine itself can be regarded as actually it's a graphic model. So although actually what I've seen is that so the deep learning actually already just like embracing a technique from different area, and so this actually the graphic model communities actually just like it share the same just like the formulation as graphic model has also just like some just like functions there. So you learn that it's an energy function and it takes exponential function, and those have some partition function or sum over all the possible combination of input x and hidden variables there. That means that for this kind of models, and there's no interaction between the input and also the output. No, there's only just interaction between the input and the output. There's no interaction between just like the units in the same layer. And one of the reasons people use this kind of simple graphic model set, so it's easily just use that kind of building blocks to build deeper architectures. And even for such kind of just like the shallow model, it can also people also show that. So it already is some just like query represented so arbitrary just like functions. If the, for example, if the x is just a binary and for the output also binary, hidden unit also binary, so it can pursue any kind of just like discrete just a distribution. One of the reasons people use IBM really just like so can make the inference really easy. So assume that we consider the IBM variation with the binary units. That means that so the hidden unit will be binary and just like the input unit will be binary. And so if we just like, usually when we do just like do the inference, so we might just, sampling will be popular method. Sampling is essentially just like the product can be first just like rewrite just like to get just like a product of conditional distributions, just the one here. And RBM can be easily factored into just like standard product of just kind of local just conditional distributions. And so if the binary units, we found out that so the conditional distribution actually is the logistic regression. And if logistic regression, that means that so we can easily compute the probability that simply just do some finite combination, apply the single model function, and to get some just like probability values. Then later we can easily just like sample the labels based on this probability, and by using just like univariant sampling technique, right? And it happens not about just like for the probability of hidden variables given the visible units, but also just like so in the for the reverse case, just like given the hidden variables and the x, just it's actually just a different input. When the inference here is easy, so and we can also just like use some technique to mostly just use to estimate the derivative. For learning the parameters, but in inference, you assume that somehow just like the parameters are fixed. And for the parameter learning, so we want to learn the just like the W and also just like B and C, which are the parameters there. And when we just like write out the corresponding, this is just like training objective. When we write out the derivative, it consists of the two parts. If you learned just like CRF before, the similar, somehow it'll be similar. And the first one must be the terminology called positive phase. So because the probability here just like x observed, right? We just need to just like get samples of h. So we just simply apply just like the sampling technique that I just mentioned before. And here is it's based on the empirical distribution, it's simple. But for that case, which just like both of the unknown, basically just like some, it's a distribution, it's a model distribution, so-called model distribution, also called just like sampling in the negative phase in the terminology. So that case will be more difficult. So Jeff Hinton suggests use a technique called contrastive divergence. So it's a good person, it's nice, approximation practice for this case. What it does mostly for the sampling in the negative phase is that so you start with some just like data points, observed data points, and use and try to sample some hidden hidden just a representation, and then it sample just like the again just reconstruct just like the visible units by just like sampling from just like from H1, and further down it can just like it can this thing can be applied for, several times will be the number of steps, and if we get just like at least one step, we can already use it to get the samples from the previous one here, get sample from the model distribution, and the practice is efficient and so works well, sufficiently well for most applications.
Maybe you can finish here for this session.
Yeah, I just want to finish here. So yeah, after break, I'll show you just like some interesting applications or just like more state of art, just like the machine learning technique.
Yeah, let's have 15 minutes break and we'll be back.
Okay, it's clear now. So from there, can you hear me? Good. Okay. Yeah, for some of you, so my went too quick. So at the end, so some of you just may not know the just like the meaning of different variables. So H would be the hidden variables. So it's the graphing models. So just standard graphing models. It has variables, hidden variables have just like observed variables X here, just here would be just like observed ones. So it would be the hidden ones, and also sometimes also called latent variables there. And the W is the weight matrix, and the C and B would be the corresponding just weight vectors for the corresponding just like variables which serve as somehow just like the bias, try to capture the bias. And this somehow written just like more just like traditional form rather than the matrix form. Okay. So the training okay. You mean the interaction here? Yeah, interactions. Huh? Ah. So you can think about the B and C. So with B and C have a large positive value. So that means that whenever if the X and H are binary variables, for example. So if the X and H is one, for example. So if both either for example, if C have large, corresponding C has a large positive value, that means that it will lead to some just like higher probability, right? So it would mean that so somehow would be bias associated with the corresponding variables. For this W here, there will be just like the combination of HI and XJ. So if we get such a combination, if both variables are one, for example, if the corresponding just like weight matrix is one, for have some large positive value, right? So will lead to also just like and just like high probability. That I call some just like to characterize the interaction between just like the two the random variables there. It's clear? So okay. Yeah, just like so the Z here is the partition function for the normalization. So in order to ensure that you get proper probability there. Okay, so the nice thing here is actually really about just like to do the factorization of the just like conditional distribution in order to just like do the sampling. So I've seen that you have some taken some just like a process inference of graph models in the last week, right? And there's no difference that if you use sampling, so you should have just like product of that kind of local, just like conditional distributions, conditional probabilities. So what you need to know is just like this very extreme case, simple case, just like so, just compute the logistic functions and get some probability here. So you go get some random, then you throw a dice to get some random value between 0 and 1. So if it's below the probability, for example, you accept it as just like, if you can accept it as then get just like some label 1. If it's just like, maybe if you get just like into another region that so of 1 minus the probability, so you can reject. It's really just a univariable just a sampling technique. So the another beauty is that so because it's a product of just like this local distribution are independent to each other. You can run such kind of sampling in parallel. Just like if there are 10 such kind of units, it just like can run 10 of them just in the same time. It's also another beauty of this. Then you can apply some GPU technique. It's like really a nice place to just like apply using just the GPU. And here, just like, in order to learn the parameters, what you need to do first, have the just like use the idea of maximum likelihood, and it end up with just like minimize the negative log likelihood. So that's why I make it here. Just the px here, just like in order to get px, you have to modulize out the hidden variables in this way. Then this way you get the px. Okay. Then later this one, so I should not go into detail, so because it's just standard routines to compute the derivative with respect to each parameters, then you'll get this form here. When you get this form here, you'll have just like many graphical models, you'll have just like some just distribution, some expectation here based on actually because the sum over just like its probability here, just like it would be the expectation on the empirical just like distribution. Here x is observed, just like previous case, and so you can directly apply the same sampling technique. And for here, it's more complex, and because you don't know both, in order to have a sample, you just need to, for example, either run Gibbs sampling, which might just like require, in practice, so we'll have long burning process. So in order to just like make it more efficient, so Jeff Hinton suggests to use contractive divergence. So basically just like you're sampling, just like project X into some hidden variables and project back to get some reconstructed input. And by using such information, just a coarse entropy, for example, if the binary units based on, then can you can do the corresponding just like parameter estimation update by using, for example, SGD. And in most cases, you need one step. In many cases, just like project to the hidden and project it back. So what sort kind of... Yeah, this is for the negative case. Negative phase, want to get the samples to for example, if I get multiple samples from the model distribution, I can take an average of them in order to get the distribution, then get to the expectation. Yeah, this part will be straightforward because this can be done analytically. So what we need to have is to get the P X tied and H tied here. Yeah, this will get through this process. This project to the hidden one, you get X, right? So you can get H, right? So you project back, you can get first, go forth after several steps, you can get some better sample. So more steps just means that you indicate different quality of sample. Just in practice, mostly just step one is sufficient. And so RBM, so yeah, belongs to the category of just energy-based models. Energy-based model, just like, and so come some call just a super category of the graphing model. So why we see here, because somehow just like in the deep learning community, people just like some concept, so we can use some concept of the energy-based model. Another that, so for the learning, so have also have some general form, for example, for the of gradient. So for the energy-based model, so just like graph model, it has some exponential function, and so to inside the exponential function will be some energy function. The goal many times is just like to the so-called energy function mostly just like for the graph model, so mostly just linear function. The goal really just like to minimize the energies in many cases. And it has also a Kondratsky partition function, which is sum over just like all the possible, just like the x here. And so if there are hidden variables, there we have, we just apply the marginalization just like on this kind of a model. And in many cases, we use also the concept of free energy. It's no more than just like when we just get some standard formula here, right? So we just take the log and over the and rewrite the exponential of some logarithms to get this form. And if we put the free energy inside, we come back to the same one. You can do the reverse order, it's more clear. Because log here, exponential here, and we come back to the form here. Yeah, it's just like some just like mathematical notations in many cases, but this notation is helpful, so when we come to the just like the gradient here, so because sometimes there's a nice interpretation here, maybe you can use to get some intuition from the graphics here. So because as I said, there's a positive phase and negative phase over there. So this corresponds to the model distribution. This is also based on the empirical distribution. So when we observe some data points, so from this in the positive phase, so I really try to just like push the energy, free energy down. And for the samples of model distribution, we want to pull it up. And when we keep doing this, somehow the two expectations will come to some equilibrium, just like the corresponding expectation will become zero. Okay, so not any RBM, so many different kind of just like deep learning models belong to the energy-based models. And autoencoder, just like deep Boltzmann machines, also just like this one, deep belief network, which is the first deep learning technique got people's attention in 2006. Which you can see that somehow the breakthroughs in this field. First, it's energy-based model. And second, what you observe is that so you cannot simply call it just either directed or undirected graphic model because they are both. So underneath this one is a sigmoid belief network. So if you use sigmoid function, otherwise you can call it a directed belief network. This one is directed model here. And this here, the topmost layer, will be RBM. And that's why we call it the hybrid models. So, and usually there's two processes, there's like two stages of learning. You will want to learn certain models. First, just like unsupervised pre-training, and followed by just like supervised fine-tuning. When we look at the formula here, it's just like the directed belief network, just no more than just like a product of a conditional property here, and RBM would be the last one, undirected model there. Oh, loader. Okay, sorry. And so let's go to some just like. It's the most intriguing part, which consists of some just like breakthrough technique. All the idea actually just like simple, so the procedure so should be understandable for everyone here. And the process just like, we have some observed units here, right? So we also have some observation of data there. And we try to, the next step, just that we construct a retrieval Boltzmann machine. And which takes just like two sets of variables, one's the visible ones, and another is the hidden ones, right? Construct the RBM. And we can just like, we just train the RBM with constructive divergence, the technique we introduced before, until just like it's reached a proper standard and it will convert, right? This would be the first hidden layer we built. Then, next step, we stack just like build another just like a retrieval Boltzmann machine on top of this one, on top of previous trained one. And previous one just like could be just like all the parameters are kept fixed. Then we start training another RBM on top of this by taking just like each one as the input. So we can keep doing this again and again, so until we get a sufficient number of layers. And so the key is that so for each kind of sampling, because just the nice, this really about the beauty of RBM, that we can end up with just like the conditional, just like a lot of conditional distribution. So we can do some easy sampling to from this layer to that layer. And for once we have the all the just layers, so the pre-training is done. Okay. Hybrid, that means that so here, this part here is undirected model, graphic models. This is directed.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's hybrid, that's why. So directed, undirected. I mean just the model itself. So for purpose of for different applications, so you can on top of this model, right? So this is just a build representation. The purpose is to build some just like abstract or just like high level representation H3 here, for example. So this kind of regarded as some just like high level features, right? So if there are features, you can put into the different classifier or just a regression model to do the task you want. Here the purpose is really just like how to pre-train the features. Yeah. Autoencoder, yeah, we'll connect. So somehow could seem there's a strong connection between the two models there. So RBM.
And then after what is after pre-training,
then you have to form the yeah, because in the past people feel that because in the field that people just simply just like these are deep network, right? So people put the classifier here, simply to train everything together, right? In the past.
Okay.
Now we just do differently, do stage-wise. Just like start with try to build the first layer until just like get good parameters and start, then begin the second layer.
This is the old version.
I just want to show the complete architecture first. Then I show just how to just build them just stage-wise. Yeah, mostly just people just like the data itself just like this. So I think what do you first for the same set of data, right? So most people use the same set of data. So for the first layer, just want to build some hidden layer, first hidden representation of just like the observed data, right? So in the second stage, so at input, you still get your same set of data here, right? So you map them to the hidden representation with the pre-trained, just like with the parameter trained in the previous step. Then this will be taken as input for to train the second RBM. Yeah. And so on and so forth. So we'll get so a lot of, or just get, when once we pre-train them, just a parameter of all the models, the pre-training process is done. So, for example, if we use a syncmoid function, so it's just like we can treat the whole thing just like some a lot of hidden layers of a certain just like syncmoid neural network. So then we can do, once we get some labeled data, we can do some forward propagation by just like get some input data here. So just use that neural network to do forward propagation, and once we have the just like representation here, we can do backward propagation, and by using just like the labels there. So this would be the process supervised fine tuning. Yeah, because this process just like there's also some just like theoretical analysis here, so people think that so this for DBN, so people can maximize just variational just like lower bounds. So if you just like have learned just a variational inference in the past, and there are also different besides just like theoretical studies, there are also some just a nice empirical study over there. So the first thing that so what we get actually from some kind of greedy layer-wise pre-training. And there are several different questions there. There's like one thing that would be just optimization, say the hypothesis. So yeah, once we do pre-training, probably just means that we can get a better initialization, so that we can get a better just like minima, because starting pre-training can place the whole model at some better initial region. And after just like the fine-tuning basically to do further just like local improvement by some local search. So optimization hypothesis is just like, it's one of the ideas there. Another thing is that the other idea over there is just like regularization hypothesis. That means that it's a special kind, okay, what's your question? Could you speak it a lot? Because here I can hardly hear you. You mean just like how do they use just like the parameter trained there to do the? Using just an unsupervised way of doing things, right? So yeah, because for RBM, for example, just like if you build another way of speaking, I think if I get your question right, so just do mean that you don't understand how to reuse the parameters learned in the unsupervised pre-training step for the supervised fine tuning, right? Or is that your question? Why it's better, right? So why the unsupervised greedy training better? So there are two hypotheses. One is just like there are two kinds of studies there. So one is theoretical study, and it would be better if you understand just the variational inference first. Just like they would maximize the variational lower bounds, the same as just like the mean field method, right? So similar idea of mean field method. Another idea, really empirically, I'm going to show now, just like so people really run extensive study to understand why just like the unsupervised pre-training is helpful. So that's what I'm going to say right now. Yeah. So yeah, because another hypothesis is really about just like another idea would be just like possibly just like regularization, it would be it's good regularization. That means that it's not necessarily to improve the training error, but it should improve the test error. Right. And here's just the experiment results. So they run intensively just like on the MNIST data set. The first thing you'll see is that it's a purely supervised neural network, and so train the supervised way, so here would be just like the error rate. So here the first thing you'll see is that and when you increase the number of layers, perhaps at the beginning, you get the performance improvement. Later, you'll get a worse improvement, worse performance, right? And with unsupervised pre-training, just like as number of layers grows, so the error rate is just like also is better. Yeah, just to get better error rate. And so this is the test error. So when you just look at just like training errors, it does not necessarily to improve the training errors. But always, most time you get better just like test errors. So that means that really it's some kind of just like regularization rather than just purely it's a good, better initialization, but it is still just like the optimization hypothesis is not totally just like correct in that case. Because the goal, the just effect really just like to get better test errors. Yeah, another thing people also tried just like to study it further by training just like multiple models, right? And try to models and try to visualize just like how the model improved during the training process. And this one is with unsupervised pre-training, and this without unsupervised pre-training, you'll see that with some random initialization of model parameters, you really just like in the whole space really just like scattered around. So there's no just like good region over there. If you use unsupervised pre-training, so somehow you're concentrated in some just like certain region of whole input space and keep improving it and until just like get the better model. And here just like three columns there, just like this one is with purely supervised fine-tuning, this was purely just like unsupervised pre-training, and this the pre-training, and we followed by the supervised fine-tuning. So from here, you can see that between the pre-training, pre-trained model, and the fine-tuned model, so the convertible characters just get just like stronger, just like to just like if there are really shapes there to make it more clear, just really just fine-tune it a little bit better. And here, if we start with some random just like parameters. The message here is just like really difficult to get a proper shape there if the number of layers is high. Yeah, by using just like the RBM, so we have also some just like interesting demo there. Let's see if the internet works. Okay. Oh, is the internet on? I just want to have some. Yeah. No, it's not about the voice. It's just like I want to get the web working. So can I not get the internet here, or just I know not which thing. Yeah, the link to the thing at the other side, I think. Yeah. Yeah, I just planned this one. Yeah, because this is just like the demo actually just like try to generate just like the characters from the trained RBM models, and yeah, that's what I'm doing. Yeah, cool. Thanks. Yeah, they have just like classification case, for example, you just like if they can't get a correct just like classification, or just like and more funny things about just like this is just like trained models. Yeah, so yeah, whenever just like, so here's the trained model. So here shows there's like actually different layer would be the hidden layers and would be the input and the hidden with the input and the hidden layers and try to regenerate just like the characters there. So it would show it for properly trained models, it should just like recover the key information from the input images. And another case would be just like classification here, just like I showed you before, just like here just when I click different characters, I will show just like if the model properly trained should just like have a good just like sign, just like ready do it correctly. 4 probably not good, but 7, 1 is, yeah. Some of them character times do the better, some of the worse. Okay, this idea of using this, can I switch back? Yeah, another family of just like of scanning models, autoencoders, and autoencoders. So actually, also just like very traditional techniques, which really appeared just like in the last century, and but recently people find different, very different kind of variations, which brings to the state of the art results. So from IBM, so especially for the constructing type. Deficants. So probably you can think about just like really, what they do, is just really just like try to reconstruct input and minimize input. Autoencoder is built based on this idea. So it has some encoder functions which map to the input to some of the hidden representation, and you have another decode information and map the hidden representation to some the reconstructing input. And the goal try to minimize the difference between reconstructed input and the input themselves. An example would be just like the encoder would be use a time function as execution function, and to project the finer combination of the input into some into the hidden representation. And in the next step, and do the reconstruct the input by using the decode function here. So in many cases, people use the transpose of the weight matrix here is so-called tight matrix. For a certain kind of type autoencoder could perform better than you separate just like weight matrices. And the last step would mirror the difference between the construct input and the input by taking the just like square loss. And if the continuous variables. And another thing interesting here is just like PCA can be also be viewed as some special kind of autoencoder by ignoring the nonlinear activity function there, and still use the transpose of the weight matrix there. And that's why, simply speaking, so the PCA actually also builds just like that's one explanation. PCA actually just like builds distributed representation, and actually they're just like linear autoencoder. That's why some experiments also show that you just simply the PCA, people also can get also good initialization of the model. And so if we have just discrete inputs, we can apply different kinds of laws. For example, if it's binary, so it would be just like the coarse entropy. And here just like or if the multinomial input, we can use just like the same one for just like multi-class, just like classification problems. So continuously, just like square loss. In general, just like people also just, especially from the usual benchmark group, they try to study that if there are more general, just like general laws for just like autoencoders. So one of the suggestions they have, just like to try to minimize the negative log likelihood of peaks given just like the hidden representations there. Here we project the input into some hidden representation. And another thing that you might ask is just like if we simply just like apply such kind of autoencoder, could we just end up with some identity function, right? So If we end up identity function, there will be no use. And so that's why people apply just like regularized autoencode with, for example, L1, L2 regularizer, or just like use a smaller dimension, project that kind of input into just a low-dimensional hidden representation, and project them back. And in this case, so the idea is somehow similar to the matrix factorization, so we really try to capture the factors, the key factors in your data distribution. And with just like since 2009, and so 8 and 9, and so people found that adding some noise proactively to the input, you might end up with a better autoencoder, better construction. So initially, people just like said maybe for just like for some autoencoder with binary inputs, so it simply set just like 20%, for example, 20% or 25% of them to zero, just like simply like ignore this part of input, simply speaking, and try to reconstruct them, reconstruct the representation, then compare the reconstructed representation with the original representation, and try to minimize the reconstruction error. Yeah, because it's not mostly we have mostly noisy data, so it's kindly so simulating the noise process, and because every time so different units will be just like set to zero, or by adding Gaussian noise, then one way of thinking this really just like to simulating the just like noisy process. Another way just like really just like doing just like that kind of projection here. Still, here you can consider just like this as some just like low dimensional manifold which generates your input data, your high dimensional input data, and by minimizing reconstruction error, if the data really data point really on the manifold, right? So really try to just like capture just like these properties here, and if noisy data, and the idea just like would be just orthogonal to the manifold, and in that case we'll try to just like get rid of such kind of information, just like to make them the model robust to such kind of noisy situation. There's also nice interpretation of such kind of autoencoders, especially with the denoising autoencoder ones. So what they did actually just like try to learn the scores. What's the scores of such kind of model? Basically, just like the derivative of log likelihood respect to the just like input. So once you get a score, you can recover the density by using, for example, the integration operation. So if you learn your math parameters in that way, so it's technique called just score matching. So you'll end up with learning parameters while ignoring the partition function. So that's why just like no matter we use RBM or use autoencoder, you might notice here is that so we really just like don't need to think about the partition function anymore. So which is really just computationally expensive for graphic models. And if we wanted to have just like deep architectures, we can really just like do we can build just like deep hierarchies a similar way as we do for just like deep neural networks. So we start with just like simple autoencoders and train until it just converges, and then by taking the output of the first autoencoder, by taking just like output of first input as input, we learn the second output encoder for the second layer and so forth. And the last, once we get a high level representation of the data, we can take them as features for any machinery for our specific applications. And there's a strong connection between just like, you know, various kinds of, you know, the autoencoders, also another one called the contracted autoencoder, which basically try to just like estimate the scores of the models. Oh, there's also a strong connection between the autoencoder and also RBM, which is estimated by the constructive divergence. So more detail, we can find them here. And I have also some nice ones for autoencoders. No, go down this way. So is this not working? Okay, good. Yeah, CommonNet just like denoid autoencoder, so it will be the demo here, just like yeah, they're working on still on just like the training autoencoder, also just MNIST data. And so here, just like what we can see here, just like so. Close it here. Yeah, here you can see some learning process here, just like the time for the propagation, backward propagation, just like how the laws changed over the time, and just like with different kind of input and things like that. So now also just like, yeah, because this tool also quite excellent, because it's one of the most high speed tools nowadays. Now, later when the practical section, we'll come back to that. And so now we think that so adding noise proactively, we can end up with just like better models, right? So now the techniques just suggest by Jeff Hinton really can be considered as just like a variation or just like of just denoid autoencoder, but he simply applies some so-called drop out operation. Drop out operation simply just like for model with just like binary input, so he drops half of them randomly, and sometimes or just like between the applications, and try to just like apply this operation not only for the visible layer here, just like for the lowest layer here, he tried to apply drop out for the different layer, but so the proportion of the unit neurons are just like deaffiliated would be differently. They're really just like application specific. And then later combine them, just like it takes a half of them. So it's really driven by the mathematical analysis. And nice interpretation of this. So every time you end up with different, you drop out, you'll have some sparse structure each time because some neurons are deactivated, right? So are ignored in this case. You'll end up every time with different, just like neural network structures, very sparse one, different architectures, and combine some results and end them. So really just like another kind of efficient bagging, because bagging really just like a different sample, random shuffle of different different random sample of the data, and combine, train different model and combine the model together to get the final output. So, and with some kind of dropout technique, so they work to get some state of art result for the just like speech recognition. So now we come to the convolutional neural network, so which just like most dominantly, just widely used the neural architecture nowadays for just like object recognition. So there are many just like, this ready applied not only to computation problems, so recently also applied to just like sentence classification, sentiment analysis problem in the computational neural network, in the just like computational linguistics communities. Nice things people observe just like so, and for the convolutional neural network, there are two kinds of layers. One's called convolutional layers, not called subsampling layer or pooling. And so for the convolutional layers, so basically what they did, we start with the linear case, just like try to get some linear combination, a finite combination of input at the local regions, and to build some hidden ones, right? And can keep further doing this, and the next things, and you can get so just like assumption really just like for each small regions, and somehow the feature there are somehow correlated, and you get first just like build some just hidden representation first, then could be sparse, could be dense. Then next thing is that so you do some sampling, pick up the most important ones. Using just like the some sampling, you can pick the one with the highest value by playing max operation, or take average of the some just like the output of just like the of convolutional operations as output. And that's the way to achieve just like the translation invariance. So here that you can see some here just like use mass pooling here. If there's translation here, if the most important signal is the one here, he'll pick the one. So locally, you can get some invariance of translation. So it's nice things that people observed. Other nice things of convolutional neural networks that so, it can work well by applying peering, just like a supervised technique. I just throw some labeled data there and train them, already get a state of art results. But people can get better results in the way that people also just like, for example, for computer vision, so people pre-train, people may want to do some object recognition task for not on the ImageNet data set, but people can pre-train the whole model in the ImageNet, and later just fine-tune their models for just like the application of interest. And in many cases, so when you apply just a convolutional neural network, so it's better off just like having just the multiple just feature maps. Because the previous the convolutional neural network really just like projection of features into a different, better hidden representation, right? So you can do the such kind of use different random initialization of your such kind of convolutional operations and end up with different multiple feature maps and do them at the same time. So it's a way of just like increasing the model capacity, and mostly they'll end up with just like better results. And yeah. Of course, at the same time, so it will just like, just get more just computation involved. That's why people just like dominantly implement them just like on GPUs. So you can get several, sometimes as 10 or several hundred of speed up when you implement them properly or by using multiple GPUs at the same time. So just another model I just shortly want to introduce, just like so really just like the concurrent neural network. So if you work on the speech recognition or just like work with natural language processing, you might notice that mostly just like work with on just a sequence of data. So in sometimes you really want to capture the long dependence. Because such as for linear tree CRF or such kind of models, mostly they assume some Markov properties, right? Markov property just like so maybe just the label of this node here depends only on the previous the previous prediction. So if you want to capture long term dependency, you think about something else. But people found out if you learn such kind of model so in supervised way, so with breadth propagation, to end up very poor results. So because just like the gradient just like change just dominantly, so in order to understand the gradient part, so maybe I'll just see this model a little bit more details. So here it will be some reconstruction with matrix. Here will be our input from previous step and apply some just like activation function. And here will be just like some input of the current time step. Here would be a bias. This will be some part for each sequence. So they are going to share the same weight while building this whole sequence here. So the problem of just like gradient is here. So once we compute the gradient with respect to the error from the labeled data, we end up with the product of many just like Jacobian matrix. So theoretic analysis shows that so if the norm here, a norm of the partial derivative here is smaller than one, it end up with just like exponentially just like decreasing of the gradient. So at the same time, just like, so if the above one, so the norm is above one, so when we multiply all of them together, the norm will just like, so increase exponentially. So it seems that the best one here would be something close to one, right? So another thing that is really hard to avoid this case, for example, so you have just, because this determined by the your weight matrices, reconstruction weight matrix, and also just like your input after applying the nonlinear operation. So it seems here that are unavoidable. So there are also people try to use different techniques to do this. So some called clipping and try to, someone who do the Hessian-free optimization. So but the technique I'm going to show you just like to try to change the model by using the long short-term memory. So the idea, the problem, the part of the model make problem is here, right? So here makes the gradient either exponentially growing or just like decreasing. So the only way we just like get some just like some norm after computer gradient with close to one, so we have some linear unit here, almost the same item, one here. So one have such kind of part in the model, people end up with such kind of model, just like short memory. Looks like a little bit complex, but here would be the linear part there from previous step. What it did, just like use so-called forget gate, which basically can be regarded as some just like one layer neural network or some just like logic regression, try use some bit to activate or deactivate just like the output of this. You can also drop this to if you think that some information is there, comes some kind of steady and want to catch really just a very long term dependencies. And this part just transform the input here, X here, into just like hidden representation, and the input gate here basically also another just like logic regression determining just like if certain output will be combined with the previous step. So with such kind of simple changes, not simple changes, just like with some kind of changes without sort go back to some just optimization techniques, there's also studies show that so it can you can get some long-term dependencies maybe just like 100 steps back, which is really amazing for sequence-based data. So if you want to just like do some time theory analysis or just like work on some data with some long sequences would be one of the choice. Nowadays, people apply it also to machine translation and so on. So by simply just like put the two LSD and model together, one for target language and one for source language, also you get very improved results. Yeah, just the time because I can skip some demos and give you some information if you want to apply deep learning in practice, right? So nowadays, so from the Usual Venture Group, which is just like Lisa Lab, so in Canada, so they use have learned framework called Theano. So the one of the most nice features is automatic differentiation. It's nice because that so you don't need to compute your derivative on your own. But something not nice that people found it a bit just like hard to do for debugging. So yeah, I just heard some complaints because they generated the just like code, C++ code automatically. And so another way, just another popular lab called Caffe. So it's widely used nowadays also in the computer vision communities. So they achieve also faster speeds in many applications. And it's a C++ based module. So, and the nice thing is that so they do not use automatic differentiation, but what they make the model very highly modularized. So they make the config of such modules into some neural network architectures easily by simply just write some configuration text files. Torch 7, so also very just like modularized and high speed library, but the language is in Luna, but Luna has a better just like connection to C++. Now at Nikita, we're developing just like also a deep learning toolkit and for natural language processing. With somehow previous models somehow specialized in the computer vision, so for natural language processing, sometimes we have a special just like need. For example, we want to integrate a lot of pre-processing steps and seamlessly into our model, and we still want to keep the high modularity similar to the Caffe and the Torch 7. And for this purpose, I also make it easy to coding, easy to develop new models. So now that's the ones under development, hopefully you can make it open source in April. Okay, and this one is in Scala and Java. So if you see, because the many people in the NLP community, so they work happily with Java and stay in the Java world. So one technique we want to use here, just like another technique we often use here, if we do not use automatic differentiation, we make sure that so the partial derivative we compute in our module should be correct, right? So we can derive the derivative analytically, so by applying our just like the math rules. So then when we build such a model, we should track if it's correct. One way to track if it's correct, simply just like use the definition of just like derivative, just like computing, just like partial derivative of that variables. In this way, simply just like takes difference between just like two laws, and by adding some just like very small number of delta H and to change the parameter bit. So in this way, we can get the very high quality, just like the estimation of derivative, and compare it to just like the gradient that we did in a more analytical way. So if they agree with each other, so we're fine. Just like we can just like put into our neural network for using. And another technique we use is called mini batch, because sometimes it's better to just like if we use mini batch, that means that so every time, just like for the gradient, we average over just like small set of just like training examples. So and sometimes we'll end up with a better prediction of a derivative. And it's also a matter just of convergence speed. So because all the gradient inside a batch, we can compute in parallel and some way of inference speed, but somehow because we have less updates, then we have just like maybe just a slower convergence. So one of the most important parameters, have parameters in the neural networks is the learning rate. So as I said, so we start with some just like initial learning rate. We should choose this one just like the biggest one that do not cause the divergence of the training objective. So we can just like start with some big number, for example 0.1, and try to decrease it until see just like a divergence of the training criterion disappear. And there's also some many different just learning rate schedule for this purpose. Because we want to achieve convergence, so one way just like decrease the learning rate according to the theory. And one way that so after tau steps, well then we start decreasing by dividing the initial learning rate by t. And another way, so more popular nowadays, is actually use algorithm, which is smartly just like adjust the learning rate based on history of gradient. So it can here I just ignore the part for the regularization. So we can easily incorporate for that original algorithm, easily incorporate L1 or L2 regularizer. So if we have a lot of hyperparameters, so one good way is just like traditionally we want to do some grid search to try every possible just like parameter combination as possible, right? So, but for deep learning, so we end up with too many just like hyperparameters, more than 10 somehow. So grid search would be not be a good idea. So the suggest, so Yusha Benju and the group suggest use a random search, basically just like you, based on the computational resource, maybe you just randomly pick up just like 100, for example, just like hyperparameter combinations and to try which one performed the best. In their study, they many times just work better than ask some experts to fine-tune them, to choose like hyperparameters. The reason is that so not all the hyperparameters are equally important. By using random samplings, random sample of them, so maybe just like can skip some just like poor just like hyperparameter settings. Okay, then so for the NLP applications, so probably just like can shortly just like say a few words because so more detailed information can be found in the Richard Rocher's the NACO ACL, so and also the recent paper of ACL. So because of time reason, just like I just shortly just show some highlights here. So mostly people in this community so they using neural variation of neural language model to learn the word representation. So and most cases this just like is a shallow just a neural network, and they end up with just kind of learned good word representation capture so-called distribution similarity. So maybe just like because a similar word, the word with similar meaning should usually have similar context. Just somehow use certain information to find to encode certain information into the word representations. And for the phrase and sentences, so there are a lot of ongoing work, but still there are still many open questions here, because for sentences or phrases easily end up with very deep architectures. So people either to use some technique as STM, or they try to just like use a shallow architecture or use a convolutional network to achieve these goals. In order to build a proper representation for phrases or sentences. And so one line of work would be done by the Richard Rocher by applying the recursive neural network, simply can be regarded as the variation of recurrent neural network. And one of the recent work really is the convolutional neural network by building by sentence representation without many layers, not proportional to the length of sentences, but this end up maybe with 5 or 6 layers. Then they achieve just like better results than use building the whole deep architecture of the sentences. So this one is from the deep convolution neural network applied on the sentiment task. This would be just like fine grain sentiment classification and binary classification. Both of them outperform previous methods. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the work. So if you want to find some kind of technique interesting and kind of working on this area more, so there's some resource it can get you just like started. Especially the deep learning website contains a lot of resources. So you go to websites, so you already found a lot of resources. Some, for example, the book, deep learning book writing by Yusha Benju's group right now, or even the NLP tutorials with deep learning techniques. Okay. So, any questions?
Let's thank Mr. Speaker. Uh-huh.